Hey folks, in this tutorial we're going to be learning about a new universe tool called Symbol Mapper, which basically looks at the luminance of a layer and applies random characters to it. It's a really interesting effect and really fun to play with, and it's also capable of a few tricks that aren't exactly obvious right away. So let's jump into it and check it out. Now I've created a solid here, but this isn't really going to do anything because there's not any variation in the luminance. So I'm gonna go to Window, Extensions, RG Universe Dashboard, and we'll look at the dashboard here. And what I want is a turbulence noise, which I can see right here, but I can use this new search field to search for effects because there are dozens of them, and this search field really comes in handy for that. So I'm gonna go to turbulence noise, and what I want to apply is this ridged preset here. So I'll go ahead and click apply preset, and I'm not done. I'm gonna go back to my effects. I'm gonna search for this time electrify, and I'm also going to search in electrify for a preset called bubbling energy. Now, as I click on that, it shows me bubbling energy, but you might have a little cloud icon here, which indicates that this cloud, this preset is in the cloud and not on your hard drive. So what you can do is click that little cloud to download it if you're following along, because it means that this is one of the new cloud presets included with the new version of Universe as well. So I'm going to go ahead and click apply preset since I've already downloaded it. And you can see what that does here. It's electrified this, added a little bit of electricity. We're not going really here for like a great look. Basically, I just want to do something that it makes it clear what Symbol Mapper is doing. Now I'm gonna go back to the dashboard, back to my effects, and I'm actually going to apply Symbol Mapper. Now if we click once on Symbol Mapper, we'll see a load of presets. I'll go ahead and remove this search for bubbling energy so we can see all these things. I don't want to apply any of these presets. I just want to apply the default settings of the effect. So I'm going to click apply effect, and I'll go ahead and dismiss the universe dashboard. Thank you for your help there. And here we see what Symbol Mapper is doing. Here's not that one. Let me go ahead and just close this up to make this a little bit more tidy so you can see what's going on. Here's before Symbol Mapper with the ridge preset, and then you can see the electrify, and then we apply Symbol Mapper, and it's looking at all of the luminance of this layer here, all of these effects, and it's applying characters randomly. And I say randomly, but kind of, it has an order to it, because you could see that the brightest points, it's given an O to that. And then in less bright spots, it's given a Y, and then on and on and so forth until we get to like T, which is kind of like in the darker areas. But it's really interesting if we go ahead and look at an area like this where we can see electrify because of the blue. If I turn off electrify, you can see that those characters disappear, or they change basically. If we were to go to turn on the transparency, we see they didn't really disappear. They just turned into T's and we can't really see them that well. But when we turn on electrify, because it changes the luminance, it also changes the characters that Symbol Mapper is using in that spot. So again, that's basically what Symbol Mapper is doing. It is looking at the luminance and applying these characters, but again, there's a lot of control here. So let's now dig in, and we'll go to this basic start composition and dig in and start actually getting into the settings and what Symbol Mapper does. I went ahead and already created this for us here. This is basically a layer with a fractal background effect. Oops, let me undo that. The fractal background effect and multitone, and then chromatone added. And that gives us this pretty little background to play with, which is fun. I pre-composed this for us to make it a little bit less cluttery. I'll go ahead and apply Symbol Mapper this way. And let's get into these settings. It's very easy, especially because it kind of comes this way where pre-process is closed up. It's normal to just jump into the grid settings and start adjusting the size of the characters and whatnot, but I recommend investigating this pre-process area. It just has brightness and contrast, but because this is a pre-process, this refers to the footage underneath the effect, it does change the results that you get, often quite dramatically. So if I were to increase brightness, again, this is not increasing the brightness of the post Symbol Mapper effect, so it doesn't see any lightness here. It's changing the way that Symbol Mapper is looking at that footage. So again, I can increase the contrast, and you can see that we're getting like brighter brights and darker darks, or I could decrease the contrast so it's all washed out more. And you see that as we do that, we get more uniformity with the characters. This letter Y is just like taken over, and it's like just all over the place here because there's so little contrast. So be aware of that, that you can get a lot of control by playing around with these pre-process settings. Now let's get to the grid settings. By default, it's set to fit to frame, which fills the whole frame with characters, but you could also uncheck this. And in unchecking this, you can specify exactly how many columns and how many rows. So if we wanted just to create a real like cool strip of characters or whatever, just like these random colors, it's kind of an interesting look. We could play with the symbol size, make these characters bigger or smaller. I'm just going to give us some more rows to play with here. And we could also play with the symbol spacing. Now, these values start at 0. And so you might think, okay, we could increase the spacing. But it's also a way to decrease the spacing. You take these into negative values, which might not be super obvious right away. So as we take this into negative values, as you can see, we are bunching these things closer together, which creates some really interesting looks and also some kind of digital looking artifacts if you really push that really hard as well. Now I'm just going to go ahead and enable fit to frame, and we have this here. And what I'm going to do is I have a text layer here, and I'm going to create a track mat with that text layer. So we just have this text that says the future, because I think this is kind of a cool way to use symbol mapper, just kind of characterize things all over the place. And so now we have our text filled with text, which is kind of meta. And we could also use this wipe direction. And this allows you to have the characters come on the screen or off the screen in different ways. So there's like left to right. And then once you use one of the wipes besides none, then the wipe setting percentage comes into play here. So then we can kind of wipe them on left to right, or we could wipe them on right to left. Or we could do this one, which is random. And I'll turn off the track mat so we can see this a little bit better here. I'll go ahead and take this wipe down, and then you can see that we're just randomly getting characters. We could make this thing feel like it's like digital art that's being populated on the screen, like something out of the 90s made with letters, or the early 2000s, that internet age where this was kind of a popular thing to do. Now we have some self-explanatory settings here in the symbol settings, but there is a hidden trick here I'm going to show you later with this, which is pretty cool. But if I don't like the way that the character, like maybe I don't like the letter P, maybe it's like a competitor's brand or something starts with the letter P, I don't know. But we can go ahead and adjust random seed until we get like the letters that we're looking for or whatever. Another thing that's pretty cool is that there's random evolution speed. So if I wanted, let's say I have 24 frames per second. So if I said I want a value of 24, then what that's going to do is it's going to randomize 24 times per second, which is going to give me random values every single frame. And maybe I want something a little bit slower than that, maybe 4. So then as I preview this, every few frames, every 6 frames, I think, if my math is right, we're going to get a change in characters, which creates this really interesting, alive look. And really no effort, no keyframes, no nothing. I love that. Now we could also adjust the symbol limit. Right now there's 8 different symbols here being used to create our art, but I could also take this down to just 2. Or maybe even just 1. And I then have right now a 5 on the screen. Now there's 2 characters in here somewhere, but I don't see any other characters. But this is giving you an idea of this, of how it's just using 1 character, or 2 in this case, to map to everything. And we could also control what types of characters are being used. So we can use uppercase letters and numbers like we are in this case, or we can use, let me bump up the character limit or the symbol limit so you could see more stuff here. Let me try 10. And then I could use lowercase letters if I want to, or symbols, or I can take off all of these and just use symbols if I want to. Or I could just use symbols and numbers, whatever I want to do. Now let's talk about the color and effects sections next here. I'm going to go to this FX start where I have this footage of Scotland Yard. So we're going to make it seem kind of like something like a spy thing. I don't know. It's not very creative. Admittedly, not very creative, but We're going to go with it. So I'm going to go into my color settings here. And the way that this works is actually pretty interesting. Right now, it's picking up the original colors of my footage. If I turn off symbol mapper, you can see that we have, you know, those colors there. It's picking up. And actually, if I went into my grid settings and I increased maybe the symbol size a little bit, maybe took down the spacing a little bit so they were kind of overlapping, then you could see a little bit more clearly how it's taking the color from the underlying footage. And if I wanted to colorize this, I can go down to color, and by default it's set to monotone, but it's really not making a difference. And that is because the color that is set here is black by default, and the blend mode is set to screen by default. So if we wanted to tint this, what I would need to do is go to this color and brighten it a bit. So if I take this to red, you see that we're going to start having this influence the color of our footage. I actually want to go to kind of like a techie green. Now, I don't like how this is being super bright because it's taking this white and it's leaving it white because the screen blend mode makes everything brighter. So because I have so much white in my underlying footage, then it's going to just blow out to white and there's not really much I can do about that. So what I need to do is change the blend mode from screen to maybe like normal or something like that. Or maybe soft light. That might work better in this case. And so we are still kind of blowing out to white a little bit, but we're getting some of those other color details back in here as well. I could also take down the color intensity, which is almost like the opacity. If I want to take it down this way or animate that, or I could take it above 100, which is pretty cool. But what I want to do is change this from a monotone to a duotone. There's also tritone, which is, you know, pretty self-explanatory after we go over duotone, but basically uses three colors instead of two colors. I only want to use two colors here, so I'm going to go to duotone. And I'm going to take my color two to kind of like a more like yellowish green, like a pale yellowish green. And then I'm going to take my color one to a slightly bluer, darker, desaturated green. So now we're having this more techie look. It's still a little bit too bright, but a lot of that brightness is actually coming from the glow, which is enabled by default. So if I open up effects, you'll see that we have two effects built in to Symbol Mapper. We have scan lines and glow, and glow is on. So what I could do is just take down the intensity of that glow quite a bit, and that kind of tames a bit. And I gotta take it way down in order to kind of really calm it down. But there's that. I could also take off the glow if I wanted to. And in this case, I do want to. A lot of times it looks really cool, but in this case, I'm not feeling it. I could also enable scan lines, which allows you to have like little scan lines as if this were a computer screen. In order to see that, I'm going to go into grid settings and I'm going to crank up the symbol size to kind of like a ridiculous value. And now we could kind of see those scan lines here. I'm going to take the line thickness maybe down to like 3, and then the spacing I could take up a little bit, and then we can see that like a little bit more clearly over those lines, maybe even larger on the symbol size, just so the people in the back can see that. So we now see these little scan lines. So maybe we could take that down to 1, and that's probably 2. That's probably too tiny. That's ridiculous. But you could see that we have these scan lines if we want to make this feel like a computer screen or what have you. And of course, we have the opacity of the line, and we could just barely have it there if we want to. And sometimes after having scan lines on, it tends to darken things because you're basically making scan lines or cutting away the transparency and basically making it black or dark. So it's cutting into it, which has an effect sometimes of darkening the footage. It feels like darker. So sometimes using scan lines and glow together is a good idea. Like if we're gonna use scan lines, then glow could bring back some of the luminosity that was lost in that process. So that's colorizing and scan lines and glow. One last thing I want to show you here. We can actually hack Symbol Mapper, which is really cool. As I mentioned, Symbol Mapper is going to look at the luminance on the footage and choose random characters based on the luminance. And so you see, like for the dark stuff here, we've chosen O, or Symbol Mapper has chosen O for us. And the brightest parts of the image is like, are there like this like E, letter E, right? So we could actually have it not only look at the luminance of the footage, but we could also have Symbol Mapper look at the size of the character and then more intelligently choose how to map those characters to areas of luminosity. So it's going to use characters like O or P that fill up more space on brighter areas, and then maybe like a comma or an apostrophe or something smaller like that on areas where things are darker. And this is pretty cool. So in order to make this work, it's pretty interesting. What we got to do, whoa, I'm all over the place. Here we go. So what we got to do is we got to go into the symbol settings here. And you have to enable two things. You have to do two things, two steps. What I need to do is take my random seed to zero. And then I also need to enable all characters. And when those two conditions are met, what it will do is it will look, so like in these brighter areas, for example, it's using the percent sign because the percent sign takes up more space. So it's even more intelligently mapping characters to our footage. And in areas like here in the dark background, it's using, I don't know, a period or a comma or a full stop if you're in a different part of the world there. And it's using these characters, it's mapping them in a more intelligent way when we do those two things. And by the way, when you go to the dashboard and you're looking at these symbol mapper presets, I'm just gonna go to symbol mapper here, you'll notice that some of these start with density. Density large, density medium, density small. And those density presets are ones that are already using this hack. So if you ever forget and you're like, oh wait, what is that thing again? What was the secret formula of those two steps? Then you could just use the density presets and it will get you there as well. So as you can see, this is a pretty nifty little tool, very fun to play with. It takes your art in a completely different direction. And as we saw with some of these examples, you know, you could just take something very, very simple, like universe presets, and turn them into really interesting original art by combining them with Symbol Mapper. So that's the tutorial, folks. Thanks so much for watching. I'm Chad Perkins. Take care.